And when we look at the animal models, it's even more alarming because it's the same medical imaging used on the kidney biopsies, the cross sections in these animal studies, show very clear changes when boldenone was administered. All right, with that out of the way, let's move over to the animal studies. These have been performed a lot more thoroughly compared to the human studies, but let's be honest, there was only one human study that has actually been performed. The rest are case studies with a ton of different variables, so we don't exactly know what the actual nephrotoxicity of boldenone is, because again, a lot of other performance enhancing drugs were used in those case reports. Of the single human study, we can poke quite a few holes in there, but in the animal studies, it's been performed a lot more thoroughly. There are biopsies, there's organ cross sections, there's organ homogenates, where they actually liquefy the organ to look at the cellular content and see what has changed comparing a control group to a group that was administered with boldenone and desalinate. So they're a lot more thorough, a lot more details. So this is going to be an even longer section compared to the human section, which we just discussed. So let's just get right into it. First study I want to discuss is performed by Dornelis et al. In 2016, titled Biochemical and Oxidative Stress Markers in the Livers and Kidneys of Rats Submitted to Different Protocols of Anabolic Steroids. So in this study, they used male Wister rats to determine the effects of boldenone and desalinate and stanozolol, winstrol, on markers of the liver and kidney function and variables of oxidative stress in these organs. Group 1 received an intramuscular administration of 5 mg per 1 kg of body weight of either boldenone and desalinate or stanozolol once per week for 4 weeks in duration. Group 2 received 2.5 mg per 1 kg of body weight of either boldenone and desalinate or stanozolol once per week for 8 weeks in duration. So group 1 and 2 both got a total administration of 20 mg boldenone and desalinate or stanozolol over either 4 weeks or 8 weeks. And group 3 received 1.25 milligrams per 1 kilogram of body weight of either EQ or Winnie, let's keep it fresh, once per week for 12 weeks in duration. So group 3 received a total of 15 milligrams of anabolic androgenic steroids. Now, for each group, they had a control group. So that means that group 1, 2, and 3 had a control group pair where they received 0.1 milliliters of olive oil intramuscularly for the same duration of time. Now keep in mind, and now we're going to start poking some holes into the study, so hold on to your hard hats. It's going to be a lot of holes. Group 1 to 3 received either veterinary grade 4 Dodge Equipoise containing 50 milligrams per 1 milliliter boldenone and desalinate in sesame oil, not olive oil, or they received Chinfield Nabolic Strong 25 milligrams per 1 milliliter winstrol suspension in water. Right, so the control group received olive oil at 0.1 milliliter, regardless of the dose of anabolic androgenic steroids which was administered. So 0.1 milliliters olive oil isn't exactly 0.1 milliliter sesame oil or 0.1 milliliter water, right? And we don't know if Fort Dodge Equipoise had benzyl benzoate or benzyl alcohol, and the same counts for the winstrol product. And olive oil intramuscularly hasn't been compounded with benzyl benzoate or benzyl alcohol. So the carrier oil control group is not exactly the same. That being said, another hole we can poke is that boldenone and desalinate isn't 100% boldenone. Boldenone and desalinate is actually 63.3% boldenone. And the other 36.7% is the undesalinate ester, which has no anabolic properties like boldenone has. It has no biological properties and effects at all. But it does extend the active life and the half-life. The half-life of boldenone and desalinate is 14 days, whereas injectable winstrol suspension has a half-life of approximately 24 hours. So that peaks quite rapidly, whereas boldenone and desalinate will peak slowly over time, after weeks. There is a little bit of a discrepancy there regarding the half-life and the ester weight. And when you account for the ester weight, you remove the ester weight and only go with the active pharmaceutical ingredient being 63.3% boldenone of the Equipoise product that was used, and Chinfield Nabolic Strong Stanozolol suspension contains 100% active pharmaceutical ingredient, 25 milligrams actual stanozolol per 1 milliliter. So there's a bit of a discrepancy there. So if you start comparing for the active pharmaceutical ingredient, comparing Fort Dodge Equipoise to Chinfield Nabolic Strong, group 1 received 3.2 milligrams per 1 kilogram boldenone, actual boldenone, and 5 milligrams tenazolol. Group 2 received 1.6 milligrams boldenone and 2.5 milligrams tenazolol. Group 3 received 0.8 milligrams boldenone and 1.25 milligrams tenazolol. So there's a huge dose discrepancy, even though you have to keep in mind that boldenone destinate with the ester is building up in the bloodstream, whereas tenazolol injections, if it's a once per week administration, it peaks within 24 hours and then starts to taper. So the pharmacodynamics between these two groups, these two studied anabolic androgenic steroids, is vastly, vastly different. But that's not all. Wister rats are about 250 to 350 grams at best. So it's not exactly 5 milligram per 1 kilogram, because these Wister rats are maybe a quarter or a third of this dose. So the dosing is going to be even lower, and it means that this 0.1 milliliter of olive oil that was being administered is not representative of the injection volume that these Wister rats got. A heavy Wister rat at, let's say, 350 grams in group 1 at the higher dosing ranges would get at most 0.035 milliliters of Fort Dodge equipoise administered, or double the dose because the concentration is half of the injectable stanozolol suspension, 0.07 milliliters of a water-based injectable. So this is already significantly lower compared to the control group of 0.1 milliliters olive oil. And as the dosages come down in group 2 and 3, the injection volume gets less and less and less. So again, not exactly comparable. You know what I'll do? I'll put everything into an Excel sheet so you guys know what the exact dosing discrepancy is between the two anabolic androgenic steroids amongst group 1, 2, and 3, as well as the injection volume between group 1, 2, and 3, comparing boldenone to winstrol to the control group of olive oil. Right? You can poke a lot of holes into the study, more holes than Gouda cheese, which I do know that rats love their Gouda cheese, and it's pronounced Gouda, by the way, in Holland, not Gouda. But that's all right. Right, we have a wide audience on this YouTube channel. So a ton of holes. I do love my Gouda cheese as well, so I do like this study. If you were to compare it to a cheese, after the experiments concluded, the scientists investigated the biometrical changes on various blood work parameters, and they assessed the reactive oxygen species from the liver and kidney homogenates. So what I mentioned before, a kidney and liver homogenate is where they do a biopsy of these organs. They liquefy it with a special technique, and then look at the contents regarding reactive oxygen species and put that in a graph, right? So when they look at the blood work parameters, most of the parameters were actually not showing significant signs of changes regardless of protocols used. So that's comparing the control group versus the boldenone and destinate groups versus the stanozolol suspension groups. Now they say that it's no clinical significance, even though when I look at the groups, table 1 for group 1, table 2 for group 2, and table 3 for group 3, there's clear noticeable changes on all of the blood work parameters. And even though they specifically mentioned that blood work parameters didn't change to clinical significance, when I look at these results, firsthand, they look very representative of the blood work changes that most bodybuilders would undergo when they use boldenone and destinate or winstrol, whether that's injectable winstrol or winstrol suspension. You see clearly that a lot of these blood work parameters go up. With group 1, you see that cholesterol goes up, right? Both in the boldenone group and the winstrol group. You see clearly that creatinine levels go up. So at least these rats gained some muscle mass after only 4 weeks. And you can clearly see that the liver enzymes went up more in the boldenone group compared to the winstrol group of group 1. But in group 2, that's actually reversed. There, you see that the liver enzymes go up more in the winstrol group compared to the boldenone group. Now again, there's a lot of variability in these results, because the sample size of the Wister rats is not that large, right? Not ranging into the hundreds, but only a couple rats per each group. It is very funny to me to see that in group 3, where the dosing protocol was reasonably low at 1.25 milligrams stanozolol and 0.8 milligrams actual boldenone per week, that serum creatinine levels went down compared to the control group. So does that mean that the dose is so low that these rats are now androgen deficient, their actual androgen content within the body went down, and their muscle mass and their metabolism actually went down, as you can see from the liver enzymes being lower and the creatinine being lower, right? Using those as an example. What is of note is that with prolonged exposure to olive oil, and maybe that's the deleterious effect after 12 weeks of chronic intramuscular administrations of 0.1 milliliters olive oil, maybe that's more deleterious than a low dose of Boldenone and Destinate or injectable Stanozolol suspension. It is of note that triglyceride levels, the longer these rats were alive, after 12 weeks, triglyceride levels are sky high, right? If you use your triglyceride levels over 200 milligrams per deciliter, you'd be worried. And based on, you know, the duration, you see that triglyceride levels go up more in the olive oil group compared to the Boldenone group and the Winstrol group. Again, you can poke a lot of holes in this. They say it's of no clinical significance. There's a lot of interesting changes over these 12 weeks comparing all of these groups amongst each other. Still, you know, the blood work changes on Boldenone and Winstrol are quite representative of what you can expect when you take these compounds as a human. So I would say that these results are interesting at best. Like they mentioned themselves, no statistical significance. So it's interesting, but you can't really draw a conclusion from these results. But when you look at the reactive oxygen species, man, those results are worrying. So they found that the reactive oxygen species were significantly higher in the high dose, short duration Boldenone treatment, so that's group one, and the lower dose, long-term duration Stanozolol treatment, so that's group three, where injectable Stanozolol suspension was administered for 12 weeks. Glutathione stores were significantly lower in the Boldenone groups compared to the Stanozolol groups amongst group one, two, and three. And when you look at the graph of the results of all of these changes, it's very, very, very clear that all of the reactive oxygen species in the kidneys were significantly higher in the Boldenone groups, right? Whether that's group one, two, or three, Boldenone had significantly higher reactive oxygen species levels and significantly lower glutathione stores. And based on these results, the scientists concluded that the kidney suffered a depletion of antioxidant defenses, and therefore its ability to combat reactive oxygen species had been compromised, resulting in oxidative damage evidenced by lipid peroxidation. Now, this is very similar to results of a study performed by Riazzo et al., where they administered 3.5 milligrams per 1 kilogram of Wisterat nandrolone decanoate twice per week for 42 days. And keep in mind that nandrolone decanoate isn't 100% active pharmaceutical ingredient, so it's not 3.5 milligrams, it's significantly less. They found that there was an evidence of lipid peroxidation and a reduction of antioxidant enzymes, which corroborates the results of this study treated with the Boldenone and Destinate and injectable Winstrol suspension. So besides the reactive oxygen species of Boldenone, which we, you know, usually say that Boldenone is very bad for the kidneys because of all of these reactive oxygen species, that's also the case with nandrolone, and that's also the case with Winstrol. And if I were to do a deep dive on this effect alone, I'm sure it's the case for all of the other steroids as well. Keep that in mind. Now, what this study did not investigate was commonly used antioxidants like vitamin C, vitamin E, and acetylcysteine, which helps with glutathione stores in the liver and the kidneys, or injectable glutathione administration concurrently with Boldenone and Destinate, or injectable Winstrol suspension, or ubiquinol. All of these might mitigate the oxidative stress which was shown on the liver and kidneys, right? There was no treatment, co-treatment of antioxidants. So maybe we can mitigate these effects, these negative effects of increased oxidative stress of Boldenone and Winstrol by co-supplementing with vitamin C, vitamin E, NAC, injectable glutathione perhaps, and ubiquinol, all of which I'm doing and most of you guys are doing. Now, I'm going to pull up another study, which is actually going to prove this. A recent study performed by Bihari et al. From 2021, so that's reasonably new, titled Boldenone and Destinate Mediated Hepatorenal Impairment by Oxidative Damage and Dysregulation of Heat Shock Proteins and Androgen Receptor Expressions, Vitamin C Preventative Role. So this study investigated the role, the preventative activity of vitamin C against well-documented Boldenone-induced liver and kidney damage, right? So that's a previous study that we discussed and a couple other studies that we're going to discuss after this. They used male Wister rats again, five groups, a control, a vehicle control, a vitamin C group where they received orally 120 milligrams per kilogram of body weight. So let's divide it by the actual weight of a Wister rat between 250 to 350 grams. So each rat would get per day approximately 30 to 40 milligrams of vitamin C. A Boldenone group injected intramuscularly 5 milligrams Boldenone and destinate, or 3.2 milligrams actual Boldenone per kilograms of body weight per week, again, divided by a quarter or thirds. And the fifth group received Boldenone and destinate and vitamin C as well. So for each Wister rat, they would get exactly or approximately 30 to 40 milligrams vitamin C per day, and per week in a single administration between 0.8 to 1.1 milligram of actual Boldenone, not accounting for the ester weight. The experiments continued for 8 weeks in duration, after which they took various blood work parameters, and they also assessed the oxidative stress indicators based on both hepatic and renal tissues, where they assessed the glutathione levels, glutathione peroxidase, glutathione S transferase, glutathione reductase, as well as malondialdehyde levels. Now, the setup of this entire study is almost identical, or at least very, very similar to the previous study we discussed, but now we have vitamin C in the picture. So what happened? Right? Based on the results, a significant rise in serum levels of urea, creatinine, and uric acid levels were observed in the Boldenone injected rats relative to the control groups. The rats co-administered with vitamin C and Boldenone showed a significant reduction in the raised urea, creatinine, and uric acid levels compared to the Boldenone injected ones. So you add in vitamin C and your blood work parameters, at least in cases of Wister rats, improve. And no apparent changes of renal function variables were detected between the control groups and the vitamin C treated groups. Now, moving on, it is of note that when you compare the blood work parameters, the kidney-related blood work parameters of Boldenone versus Boldenone plus vitamin C, it's very, very clear, right? Urea levels are very closer to the control groups with vitamin C treatment compared to Boldenone alone. And that's the same for creatinine, that's the same for uric acid, that's even the same for electrolyte levels, the sodium and the potassium, even though sodium levels went down in the Boldenone and vitamin C groups compared to the control groups. And potassium levels went up significantly, especially in the Boldenone group. And I might be mistaken here, but a potassium level of 7.4 milliequivalent per liter, that's very, very close to a heart attack level if that was the case in humans. So that is of note, right? All of the other markers changed marginally, very similar to the results we saw in the previous study, right? Liver enzymes went up in both the Boldenone group and the Boldenone plus the vitamin C groups. And when we scroll down a little bit to the hepatic and renal oxidative stress markers results, you see that rats administered with vitamin C orally for 8 weeks in duration revealed non-significant changes in hepatic and renal oxidant or antioxidant markers compared to the control groups. So no significant changes between rats treated with vitamin C or without vitamin C. But comparing the intramuscular injected rats with Boldenone for 8 weeks in duration, was a significant increase in malondialdehyde content and a significant reduction in glutathione stores, both in the liver and the kidneys. And when you compare that to the Boldenone plus vitamin C group, you see that malondialdehyde levels went up, but less significantly compared to the Boldenone group just by itself. And glutathione stores were significantly higher with the Boldenone and vitamin C group compared to the Boldenone group. So based on these results, it's very safe to say that when you go on Boldenone, just as a protective measure for your blood work parameters and your glutathione stores, even though vitamin C doesn't directly contribute to glutathione levels. So imagine if you actually take N-acetylcysteine or injectable glutathione alongside your Boldenone, it is acting as a very, very, very protective and prophylactic method to keep your blood work parameters and your antioxidant levels in range, or at least more favorable compared to taking Boldenone just by itself. So I would say that vitamin C and Boldenone go hand in hand, if after this video you're still interested in taking Boldenone and destinate. When we scroll down to the kidney biopsies, even more alarming results. And this is quite alarming for me because I've done quite a lot of ultrasounds and imaging on all of my organs. And when you look at these cross sections of the liver and the kidneys, right, clear structural changes. So based on these results, various necrotic or nephropathic changes were seen in the Boldenone injected animals. These changes involve around the glomeruli, the tubules, and the interstitial tissue. Vitamin C supplementation showed a noticeable nephroprotective effect as the renal sections of the Boldenone plus vitamin C treated animals showed a significant reduction in the frequencies and severities of most of the boldenone-induced histological changes, yet the kidneys did not maintain their normal histology. So if you take boldenone, your kidneys and livers will look worse. And when you take boldenone with vitamin C, your kidneys and liver will look less worse, but still worse than without ever touching boldenone in the first place, or other anabolic androgenic steroids in the first place, albeit that those studies, as far as I can tell, haven't really been performed in a similar setup. But more deep dives could be occurring in the near foreseeable future if you guys just ask me for it. Okay, let's scroll down a little bit more. The increase in uric acid levels may be caused by a decreased clearance due to a glomerulus filtration rate impairment or local tissue hypoxia, or an increased renal cell breakdown. On the contrary, vitamin C co-administration concurrently with boldenone significantly reduced renal function impairment. So renal function still went down, but the impairment of renal function was less. And similarly, in another study performed by Al-Timimi et al. In 2019, also reasonably recent, 4 years old, they showed a significant protective effect of vitamin C against gentamicin-induced nephrotoxicity. This protection can be described as a compensatory mechanism involving the induction of antioxidant enzyme activities as a defense system by reducing reactive oxygen species and increasing the nitric oxide to prevent free radical-induced cellular transformation. Let's look at the conclusion. This study showed that vitamin C co-treatment significantly decreased hepatorenal impairments resulted from boldenone injections for 8 weeks in duration. And the hepatoprotective and renoprotective effects of vitamin C can be highly associated with its antioxidant activity. Long story short, you want to use boldenone or anything else, any other anabolic androgenic steroids that increases oxidative stress, you better damn well make sure you supplement with vitamin C. Personally, I've supplemented with 1,000 milligrams vitamin C with each meal for over a decade. So when I eat 4 meals per day, that's 4,000 milligrams vitamin C per day. And when I'm in the off season eating 6 meals per day, you know, eating a lot of nutrients because I'm training a lot harder, probably a lot more oxidative stress, more steroids involved in that context, 6,000 milligrams vitamin C per day. I've done this for years. And guess who doesn't have any issues with their kidneys? And yes, I've used plenty of boldenone and destinate back in my day. And keep in mind, that all came from underground labs with God knows what synthetic carrier oil. I've never used veterinary grade Fort Dodge Equipoise or Pfizer Equipoise brewed in sesame oil with 50 milligrams for 1 milliliter. So I probably would never even try that. I mean, who knows what carrier oil I actually injected for all of those years that I was still using boldenone and destinate. Was it ethyl oleate? Was it MCT? Was it cottonseed oil? Was it propylene glycol, or, you know, all this synthetic garbage that I wish I never took, but still did because I didn't know any better. There was nobody on YouTube telling people to stay away from those synthetic carrier oils. And I know a lot of you underground labs are actually watching this and making the appropriate adjustments for the products that you're going to produce in the next batches. So please do, please stay away from that synthetic solvent because it's ultimately dissolving the kidneys of your customers and causing cardiovascular damage over longer periods of time. Still, I've always supplemented with vitamin C. I've used a decent amount of underground lab boldenone and distillate back in my day, and my kidneys are working just fine. My cystatin C is in range, and even though my creatinine levels are elevated, when I do a 24-hour urine collection test and I check my serum creatinine levels versus my urine creatinine levels and the electrolytes and the albumin, whatever else you can assess with a 24-hour urine collection test, my glomerular filtration rate, not estimated, the actual glomerular filtration rate, no E in front of GFR, 170 or higher, proven with many 24-hour urine collection tests. Is that the vitamin C? I'm sure it was a contributing factor besides the astragalus root extract that I've been using at pretty high dosages for the last multitude of years, ever since Dante Trudell made us aware about the benefits of astragalus root extract regarding kidney health. Now, those studies will probably never be performed, either on human subjects or animal models, right? Co-administration of boldenone and destinate or other anabolic androgenic steroids and vitamin C and injectable glutathione and astragalus root extract, because it's probably too expensive and the medical community probably doesn't care about our weird personal choices regarding the building of muscle tissue and trying to keep ourselves as healthy as possible in the process. Still, a ton of anecdotal evidence out there of people who improve their kidney parameters with antioxidants, vitamin C, injectable glutathione, and astragalus root extract, regardless of the anabolic androgenic steroids that they use. Moving on to three studies performed by Tousson et al. Between 2012 and 2013, so these are a little bit older, still good studies. I like these studies and how they were set up in Egypt. They were all performed on rabbits, and that's why I'm going to pull them together, because the results are a little bit overlapping. And again, they were all performed around the similar time periods. Study number one is titled Deterioration of Glomerular Endothelial Surface Layer and the Alterations in the Renal Function After a Growth Promoter Boldenone Injection in Rabbits. Study two, titled Histopathological Alterations After a Growth Promoter Boldenone Injection in Rabbits. And the third study is titled Physiological and Biochemical Changes After Boldenone Injection in Adult Rabbits. So again, all performed on adult rabbits in the context of figuring out what the biological changes in these rabbits are after a growth promoter has been administrated. In this case, that was Boldenone undecinate. Now, before we get into each study separately, it is of note that only study 1 of 2012 specified that the Boldenone undecinate was compounded in olive oil similar to the control group. So you have a control group similar to the previous studies, one control group administered with olive oil intramuscularly, and the examined groups administered with Boldenone undecinate compounded in olive oil intramuscularly as well. From this, we could assume that study 2 and 3 also used olive oil as the carrier oil, because again, all three studies were performed by the same people around 2012 to 2013. They were performed at the Tanta University in Egypt. There's two other studies which I would like to mention, and I'll discuss that a little bit later in this video. Similar animal studies have been performed by Oda et al. Titled Adverse Effects of Anabolic Steroids Boldenone Undecinate on Reproductive Functions of Male Rabbits, and another study by El Majoub et al. In 2012 titled Evaluation of Boldenone as a Growth Promoter in Broilers, Chickens, Safety and Meat Quality Aspects. This study listed that they used Equigun by Lab Tormel Cooperation, produced in Mexico, which contains 50 milligrams per 1 milliliter Boldenone undecinate produced in sesame oil. So at least we know that Egypt, at around this time that these studies were performed, from 2012 to 2015, that veterinary grade Boldenone was available in Egypt. So we can rule out that in the context of these studies, they didn't use underground labs like we can suspect from the studies which were performed on human subjects at the beginning of this video. So they either had access to veterinary-grade Boldenone in sesame oil in study 2 or 3, or they used a self-compounded Boldenone undecinate in olive oil like study 1 of 2012. Again, I'm poking a lot of holes into these studies, and even though I like the results and the overall setup of these three studies, poking holes is what this video is all about. These three studies didn't track changes in blood pressure. Might be difficult amongst animals, but that seems to be non-occurring in all of the animal models that I found these studies on. Co-administration of antioxidants was not performed, and neither did they measure inflammatory markers like C-reactive protein, whether that's conventional or high sensitivity, homocysteine, ferritin levels, or neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio, right? All of that was not assessed. Still, if you use veterinary-grade products or self-compounded Boldenone undecinate, I'm going to assume, right, that inflammatory markers didn't increase, because that's usually only observed with terrible underground labs. Okay, let's move over to study one. 36 adult New Zealand rabbits were divided in four groups. A control group included the animals which were injected intramuscularly with olive oil dissected after 3 weeks, and three experimental groups where the animals received 1, 2, and 3 intramuscular injections of 5 milligrams per kilogram of body weight of Boldenone undecinate, being 3.2 milligrams per kilogram actual Boldenone. They were dissected after 3, 6, and 9 weeks, respectively, and the interval of the dosing of Boldenone was every 3 weeks. So group 2 received 1 injection, right, because they were dissected after 3 weeks. Group 2 received 2 injections, dissected after 6 weeks, and group 3 got 3 injections, dissected after 9 weeks. So the overall dosing is 5 milligrams, 10 milligrams, and 50 milligrams Boldenone undecinate, with a small percentage of that being actual Boldenone. When you look at the results, comparing group 2, 3, and 4, you see that urea went up with group 2 and 3 compared to the control But with group four, which a longer duration of boldenone treatment, urea actually went up, but less compared to group two and three. And when you look at the creatinine levels, you see that they steadily increased. Now, what I'm wondering, and what this study didn't specify, is if the weight of the rabbit increased, did the dosing protocol of the boldenone undecanoate go up as well? If they're dosing this 5 mg/1 kg, but these rabbits are gaining weight, gaining size, maybe the first administration, there were only 1 kg, 5 mg boldenone undecanoate, but by the second administration, 3 weeks later, there were 1.2 kilograms. So that's what? 6 mg boldenone undecanoate. And then by the third administration at week six, if that's correct, maybe there were like 1.5 kilograms already. So now they would get 7.5 milligrams boldenone undecanoate. I couldn't find that in this study. If the dosing protocol increased as the body weight levels increased, or they used the body weight at the start of this experiment and the injection protocol was exactly the same, right? That's something that I wonder if we're going to go by milligram per kilogram of body weight. Maybe that's one of the reasons why creatinine levels actually start shooting up, because the dosing protocol went up and their muscle mass increased accordingly, right? They got more anabolic and more muscular along the way. Poor rabbits. They show that total protein, globulin, urea, and creatinine concentrations significantly increased, while albumin and albumin to globulin ratio significantly decreased after 1, 2, and 3 intramuscular administrations of boldenone compared to the control groups. Very interesting results. Again, very similar, very comparable to what we would see in bodybuilders using boldenone or other anabolic androgenic steroids with prolonged exposure. The longer you take them, the worse your blood work parameters are going to get. And when you scroll down to the microscope imaging of the cross sections of the kidneys of these rabbits, especially after 9 weeks of boldenone administrations, group four, clear structural changes. Group four exhibited severe histopathological lesions. Renal glomeruli completely lost their typical shape with the appearance of some vacuoles of different shapes and sizes. Marked decrease in their size was observed compared to the other groups, being the control group and group two and three. The mean value of the glomerular diameter and the mesangial area appeared wider compared to the other groups. Moreover, they had severe blood vessel congestions and dilation. Man, doesn't sound good. And when you scroll down to the discussion of this study, another note on the blood work changes, which we already discussed, and the histopathological examination elucidated a significant glomerular mass reduction that accompanied with a widening of the mesangial areas. These changes were adjunct to a severe congestion of the blood vessels and the expression of CD34, a marker for endothelial cell deterioration. Instances of glomerular sclerosis also appeared significantly high after boldenone injections. Maybe that's the reason why a lot of these pros of the 1990s, give or take, suffer from glomerular sclerosis. Again, this is in a rabbit model. No mention of co-administration of antioxidants, no tracking of blood pressure, no tracking of systemic inflammation, which could contribute to the worsening of kidney function. Still, when you look at the structural changes, it is very, very noticeable. And all things considering, I would say that these studies have been performed better than the studies, the animal studies that we discussed beforehand. All right, moving over to study two with the exact same study parameters, a control group with intramuscular olive oil administrations, three groups which were administered with 5 mg boldenone undecanoate with 3 week intervals, dissected after 3 weeks, 6 weeks, and 9 weeks. When we look at these results, they actually have hematology results. You see that red blood cell counts and hematocrit levels drastically increased the longer that these rabbits were exposed to boldenone. So the control group had a hematocrit of only 31%. And after 9 weeks of boldenone administrations, it went up to 42.5%, give or take, percent. Hemoglobin also went up. Red blood cell count also went up. So that's very clear changes in hematology. And this is, of course, something that we all know in the bodybuilding community. The longer you take boldenone, the worse and the higher your red blood cell and the higher your hematocrit is going to be. Clear changes in kidney blood work parameters. Creatinine went up the longer they were exposed to boldenone. Same for urea, although similar to the previous study, group four showed lower urea concentrations. Testosterone levels also went up. So this makes me wonder if Boldenone started detecting its testosterone on these rudimentary testing equipment. And testosterone went from 0.46 milligrams per milliliter up to 1.5 milligrams per milliliter. But we all know that Boldenone isn't exactly testosterone. And follicle-stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone also went up. How is that even possible? I'm not exactly sure. You let me know down below in the comment section how a rabbit administered with 5 milligram per 1 kilogram Boldenone undecanate gets higher luteinizing hormone and higher follicle-stimulating hormone levels. Maybe that's the reason why their testosterone levels actually went up. You go on Boldenone undecanate and you get additional LH and FSH and more testosterone production. If only, right? Scrolling down, the scientists noted that anabolic steroids could stimulate erythropoiesis, a mechanism that may occur by stimulating erythropoietic stimulating factor. Present results showed that Boldenone administration caused a significant increase in serum liver enzymes, ALT and AST, urea and creatinine concentrations the longer they were administered with Boldenone. So a steady increase from group 2, 3 to 4 compared to the control groups. So the study is a little bit in contrast to the previous study performed on rats, where they mentioned that there was no statistical or clinical significance regarding the changes in blood work parameters comparing control groups to Boldenone administered groups. This study showed clear changes in blood work parameters, especially the longer these rabbits were administered with Boldenone. So again, maybe there's a difference between how rats metabolize Boldenone and undecanate compared to how rabbits metabolize Boldenone undecanate. Let's move over to the last study of this group of three studies, also performed on New Zealand rabbits. Similar setup, a control group which received an intramuscular administration of olive oil for 6 weeks, and a second group who received two intramuscular administrations, 5 milligrams Boldenone undecanate per time, so with 3 week intervals, which were dissected after 6 weeks. This study showed that kidneys from treated rabbits with Boldenone showed variable pathological changes in the glomeruli in some parts of the urinary tubules when compared with the kidneys of the control rabbits. And the most severe changes were observed in part of the kidneys I can't possibly pronounce. I've tried it many different times already and I'm not going to try even further. When you compare the control groups to the Boldenone administered groups dissected after 6 weeks of this experiment, clear structural changes, right? In parts of the kidneys I can't pronounce and it's been too long, so I'm not even going to try. And when you scroll down to the discussion, the results showed that intramuscular Boldenone administrations had a marked adverse effect on cardiac and skeletal muscle. Not so sure about the skeletal muscle. Those are the results we're after. We don't want the results on cardiac muscle and all of the other tissues, but skeletal muscle, yes, please sign me up. I want to bodybuild this skeletal muscle to something that looks cosmetically appealing and gets me a ton of respect on the internet and the gym that I go train in. Again, maybe the rabbits weren't really after that, but as a bodybuilder, you certainly are. Intestine, liver, and kidney, and testes and brain tissues also had marked adverse effects, specifically mentioning that the glomerulus mass reduction and multifocal glomerular injury in the kidneys was present. Man, these medical jargon sometimes is a mouthful, and if I mispronounce something or it sounds horrendous, my sincere apologies, I've been recording for the last couple of hours. Now, these three studies, when you look at it as a whole, I found that these studies were performed quite well, right? Control groups, you know, prolonged Boldenone exposure with clear signs of worsening of blood work parameters and worsening of the biopsy results when examined under the microscope. Right, these cross-sections showed absolute signs of degeneration and damages in the kidney tissues. We don't exactly know what the Boldenone product of study 2 or 3 was, but we can exclude that underground lab products were used, like in the study performed on humans, which we mentioned at the start of this video. So they only used veterinary grade or compounded Boldenone undecanate, potentially in olive oil, like in study 1 of this group of studies. And again, I would say that these three studies are the best studies that we have on the subject of how nephrotoxic Boldenone is and how deleterious it could be for your overall kidney health and functioning. These are the best studies I could find. When you look at the cross sections of the kidneys, you see clear structural changes and clear changes on blood work parameters. There's a couple other studies I would like to discuss just to kind of confirm what we saw in the rat and rabbit studies. Another study performed by El Majoub et al. In 2015, titled Evaluation of Boldenone as a Growth Promoter in Broilers, Chickens, Safety and Meat Quality Aspect, also performed in Egypt, but not by the exact same scientist who performed those three studies back in 2012-2013 at the Tanta University of Egypt. They used a control group which was administered with 0.1 milliliters sesame oil in a single administration at the start of this experiment, and the other group was administered with 5 milligrams boldenone and decinate per 1 kilogram of body weight coming from Equigun produced by Laboratories Tornil, Mexico, containing 50 milligrams per 1 milliliter boldenone and decinate, also produced in sesame oil administered at a single administration at the start of the experiment. So finally, we have a control group and an examination group which used the same carrier oil. Man, only took hours of research. Okay, so blood samples were collected at the first week, the second week, and the third week post-administration. When you compare the blood work results, again, you see that hematology went up, red blood cell count went up, hematocrit went up, hemoglobin went up. And when you look at the white blood cell count, that actually went down, which is a common occurrence with steroid users. When you take steroids, your white blood cell concentration goes down, generally speaking. And when you look at the liver and kidney-specific blood work parameters, all of those increased. Alkaline phosphatase increased compared to the control group. Liver enzymes increased compared to the control group. Creatine phosphokinase levels, urea levels, creatinine levels, they all increased compared to the control groups. And that's the same with cholesterol levels. Regarding the liver of the chicks treated with boldenone, they showed mild dilation of the portal veins associated with diffuse inflammatory cell infiltration in between the hepatocytes. And when you look at the kidney results, this shows that the boldenone-treated boiler chicks showed congestion of the blood vessels and focal inflammatory cell infiltration in between glomeruli and tubules. So there are clear signs of inflammation both within the kidneys and the liver. I don't think that's due to the sesame oil because the control groups didn't show those signs of inflammation. And again, at least in this study, both the control groups and the examined groups with boldenone administrations both had sesame oil administrations. Keep in mind that urea and creatinine values after boldenone administrations suggests that the drug might cause renal damage. But the scientists also specifically mentioned that the formation of creatinine is highly dependent on muscle mass. And they also mentioned that serum creatinine levels of birds are significantly lower than that of mammals. So when you look at all of these blood work parameters of the rat studies, the rabbit studies, and the broiler chick study, you would say that there's clear signs of renal damage, nephrotoxicity. But keep in mind, with progressive administrations of boldenone, you would think, you would assume, you could expect that body weight goes up, right? As shown in these studies, but muscle mass also goes up. And muscle protein metabolism certainly increases. That's what we're after when we're using anabolic androgenic steroids. So you can assume that all of the metabolic markers related to muscle protein metabolism will go up as well. That doesn't mean that there's clear signs of renal damage. How many of you guys see that your urea, your blood urea nitrogen, your creatinine, and a couple other kidney-related markers go up? It doesn't mean that your kidneys are impaired or damaged. It means that muscle protein metabolism and all of the metabolic waste products produced in your muscles when you stimulate them with anabolic androgenic steroids go up. Now, that doesn't negate the fact that when all of the histological cross-sections or the homogenates are examined, you don't see clear structural changes, right? That was shown in the rat, rabbit, and broiler chick studies. It is very concerning. It is very alarming. I would love to see those results being reproduced in human models, but unfortunately, as of now, the data isn't there. But besides that single case study of a human subject being admitted to the hospital with severe rhabdomyolysis, there's no longitudinal data regarding the changes in overall blood work parameters. And we all know that chronically elevated blood pressure is deleterious for your kidney health. So we don't know the blood pressure of the human subject of that only human study that was performed. We don't know the blood pressure of the rat study or the rabbit study, or in this case, the broiler chick study. Keep that in mind, right? It's very important to know that blood pressure is deleterious for kidney health. And if that's not being monitored, then we don't know the exact roots of these structural changes as being observed in this cross sections or the homogeneous of the kidney tissue. There's one single study that I would like to discuss, but it's unfortunately not available as a full publication. You can find the link down below, and maybe in the future we can actually assess this study when it's being published and we can find it on Science Hub. This was performed by Sessai et al. In December 2022, so this is only a couple months old. This is titled Experimental Studies on Androgen Administration in Animal Models, Current and Future Prospective. This study investigates the effects of boldenone on various organs of various animals using 8 different studies performed previously, some of which we undoubtedly discussed already in this video. They did the same for other androgens to see what particular experimental study showed in animal models. Again, if anybody can find it, please link it down below, and maybe I'll do a follow-up video regarding, you know, the deleterious kidney effects of boldenone administrations in animal models. Now, what do all of these studies lack? We already poked a significant amount of holes in there to the point we can all start working for Krispy Kreme or Dunkin' Donuts. We don't know the cystatin C levels, not in serum and not in urine, right? We use that as a gold standard to determine kidney health in humans. Cystatin C testing was not performed in the human studies or the animal studies. 24-hour urine collection tests have not been performed. Kidney ultrasounds, we did get cross-sections and homogenates, but no actual kidney ultrasounds in humans or the animals. Longitudinal data of blood pressure wasn't there. Risk assessment regarding the quality of the boldenone products wasn't there. And even though we can kind of assume that the boldenone was either compounded or coming from veterinary grades, with that single human study, we don't know what the actual boldenone products was. And it didn't assess what the dihydroboldenone concentrations were or the other boldenone metabolites. Maybe, just speculating here, but there is some merit to it, maybe because the HPTA is shut down in these rodent models of the rats, rabbits, and boiler chicks, there's no serum estradiol present or other estrogens, which could be renal protective. We do know that estradiol has an antioxidant effect in the endothelium. And guess what? There's a lot of endothelial space within the kidneys because that's how all of the toxins and the metabolites diffuse and pass into the urine, right? Simply speaking. So maybe the dihydroboldenone is being converted to a higher rate in these animals. Maybe they have more 5-alpha reductase activity compared to humans. We do know that in human subjects, the rate of which boldenone converts into dihydroboldenone is approximately 2-3%. And maybe that's more in the animal studies. That's why the structural changes of the kidneys are more observed or observed to a higher extent compared to that human study. Right? You have to keep that in mind. Maybe serum estradiol levels were chronically low. Maybe estradiol is the missing link in this picture, just like vitamin C is the missing link regarding the effects of reactive oxygen species and the depletion of glutathione stores within the kidneys and the liver in the studies we just discussed. Maybe we need vitamin C and estradiol to be sufficient at all times when boldenone is present in our bloodstream, right? We can poke a ton of holes in these studies. Still, this is the best data that we have, the only data we can draw conclusions from up until now. Do we need more human studies? Of course we do, but those are all going to be observational studies where we can't exactly control the variables, because since boldenone undecanate is a veterinary medication, it would be considered unethical to start prescribing and administering various dosages of boldenone for various duration models to human subjects. And even death row inmates have rights. I believe the last thing something that horrible would ever be performed was when Japan invaded China with all kinds of human experiments. And in this day, it would never be performed to that extent. So I think going forward, all we would have on human subjects is observational studies. Maybe additional studies will be performed in animal models. And I think if follow-up animal studies would ever be performed as scrutinously as I just explained to you guys, the costs of each of these studies would increase tenfold, right? Do you get a return of investment on that? Probably not, because only the bodybuilders would actually care. And let's be honest, none of the bodybuilders are going to pull together, start a GoFundMe to do these studies for the sake of our community. So based on the studies we have up until now, I would say that boldenone is definitely not kidney approved. I would avoid Boldenone going forward at all costs if you care about your kidney health. All right, this is the data that we have, and based on this data, I would say that Boldenone is not approved. So, I'll leave it here. I know it's a very long video. I hope you found it entertaining and useful, right? If you want to see more deep dives, consider signing up for the YouTube membership or the Patreon membership so you can vote for upcoming deep dives. Leave me a super chat or a super like if you find this to be useful and you don't want to be part of a membership. A donation is always highly appreciated because these deep dives take hours to research and hours to record and even more to edit. But I outsource that to my editor now, so that's completely up to him. If you are worried about your kidney health and you need some help interpreting your blood work results because you took way too many cycles of Boldenone and Destinate in your time, head over to Merrick Health if you reside in the United States. Do your blood work there. They have excellent patient care coordinators who can help you interpret your blood work results. And if you don't reside in the United States and you do your blood work somewhere else, feel free to send them over to me. We can always schedule a consultation, even when you live in the US, right? I'm always available for consultation to help you interpret your blood work results and let you know whether you have impaired kidneys or not. I will ask for a 24-hour urine collection test and a cystatin C test because those are the gold standards for kidney health. You can find all of my sponsors and affiliates down below in the YouTube description section or head over to my website, vigorsteve.com, where there's even more sponsors and affiliates there. Follow me on Instagram and TikTok at vigorsteve. Join the Patreon page. Join the YouTube membership if you would like to support this YouTube channel. And the Vigorous crew, you guys know what to do. A front double bicep for you guys. Haven't touched Boldenone in ages, but I think some of this muscle tissue was definitely accrued with the use of Boldenone on Destinate. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.